On that break, we are asking you the question, where is the love? Where is the love for your neighbors? Where is the love for humanity? Where is the love for people who have battled infertility and who have battled baby loss? Today, we're going to be talking pregnancy and baby loss with someone who's been through it and conquered it and has decided to use her experience to help other women. We also have our doctor, Dr. Kemi Ezenwanne, here with us in the studio. Thank you for joining us, Dr. Kemi.
Thank you.
And we also have Omotade Alalade of Baby Heaven. Thank you for joining us, Tade.
Thank you.
Now, this is a very interesting panel we have right here. Tade, who's been through baby loss. Maybe this would just be a fantastic opportunity for you to quickly tell us your story. You are the founder of Baby Heaven Foundation.
Yes.
And you founded this because you had been through this.
Yes.
So tell us your story.
Okay, so I dealt with infertility more or less after I got married. And I dealt with that for a bit, not too long. And then after I got blessed with twins, I then had a late miscarriage. And I think that was the moment I knew I had to help other people struggling with this issue. Because I became depressed, I became crazy, I became someone else that I didn't recognize. And I knew that a lot of women in Nigeria suffering with silence, with no one to turn to, no one to talk to. So that really more or less founded this foundation.
Wow. So, of course, you just said your experience played a vital role in helping you create this foundation, your Baby Heaven.
Yeah.
How did you overcome it, your depression, and you're not a medical doctor,
no.
And how come you decided to help people? Is it because of the psychological part to help people overcome this?
Yeah. Basically, first of all, when I went through it, I kind of was lying to myself, if I use the word, that I was stronger than this, I could deal with this, I didn't need anybody else. You know, I could go through it on my own. And the more I thought I could do that was the more I found myself going down into this depressive state. And the more I went into it was the more I started pushing everybody away, my family, my husband, my friends. And the moment I actually went out to seek help was when my husband came to me. I was like, okay, Omotade, I can't handle this anymore. I'm grieving with you and you're pushing me away as well as everybody. So that was the moment I knew that I couldn't go through this by myself. I needed external help. So I started looking for people. I couldn't find anyone. Without it being, how did you know what I went through? I'm not even ready to talk about it. I didn't want to start dealing with all that. I just needed help. So then God sent, I just literally prayed, and God sent a lady to... God sent a lady to speak to me about her journey, about she started relating to me on exactly what I was going through, because I never thought I would ever find happiness. I never thought I would be able to get past it. I just thought that this is the end and it was I wouldn't be able to cope. And she just let me know that I could get past this. I could be stronger than this if I allowed myself to, you know, open up myself to what I was going through, grieve if I needed to grieve, take my time. You don't have to rush to get back into everything. You don't have to, you know, go to people's houses, see babies, do this, do that. You know, you literally go at your own pace, at your own time. And with time, you'll get past it. But what really helped me was the fact that I had somebody else to talk to that understood what I went through.
And it's such a beautiful thing that you recognize the fact that you had someone to talk to,
yes,
that helped you through it, and you're,
yes,
willing to do the same for other women.
Yes.
Now, let's talk to Dr. Kemi about infertility. Now, Tade said shortly after she got married, she had to battle infertility. Yeah. Infertility, and then she also lost her child after finally getting pregnant. She lost her child. So at what point should a married couple be worried if they don't have children? At what point can they say, okay, this is time for us to check if there are infertility problems? Because you see how you're getting married, and on the wedding day, they are praying for you 9 months after, and everybody's shouting, amen. And 9 months after, there's no baby, and you see some women already freaking out. So at what point should a woman start freaking out? Or maybe not start freaking out, but go
seek
for check.
Help.
Yeah.
Actually, infertility is defined as the inability to conceive children after regular, unprotected sexual intercourse for 1 year. So if for a year, a couple has been together, you know, they've had regular unprotected sexual intercourse, and this regular is at least 3 times in a week. If they have done that for a year and the woman has not been able to get pregnant, then the couple is said to be infertile. So you have a lot of people, and there's primary infertility and secondary infertility. Primary infertility is that the woman has never been pregnant. And then secondary infertility is that she has probably been pregnant before, and then for some reason she's trying to have a baby and she just can't. Mm. So you have people that will share their stories of infertility, and they'll tell you, I know a woman who had a baby, and then she did not have a child for at least 13 years. So by the time her first son was 20, she now eventually had a little girl,
wow,
13 years after, who is about 8 now as we speak. So you have, you know, those, you have, you know, different categories. And I think there's a lot of pressure on people. I mean, I've been married for a month and I've had people call me, ah,
so are you serious?
My mother said, so the next
even
time
the food they ate on the wedding day.
I'm not even joking that I've had calls. I've been asked, ah, twins, right? You have twins, you know? And then my mom will say, ah, so I can't visit you. I've not seen my mom since I got married. I can't visit you until it's time for a move. And I'm like, mommy, who came up with all those rules? Mm-hmm. So you have a lot of pressure from society. And I would never forget a couple. They just had their baby and they had been married for 4 months. And the husband came to me, you know, oh, Dr. Kemi, I know you're a doctor. My wife has not been able to take him. So, because I had not known him for too long, I was like, oh, really? Okay, so what's the problem? I started asking questions. I said, how long have you been married? And he said, 4 months. I said, I have no business talking to you. When you've been married for, I said, how old is your wife? Because the thing is, for women that are 35 and above, after 6 months, then you can start looking into the issues. But if they're younger than 35, then there really is nothing to worry about until after a year of regular unprotected sexual intercourse. So I told him, I said, his wife is 28. She's 28 right now, you know, and I'm like, I don't have any business with you until after a year. You know, he came back to me 2 months after that. The wife said, oh, the sister took in on the night of the wedding. That's the younger sister. The elder sister got pregnant a month after, and that's, so there must be something wrong with her. You know, so you have all these beliefs.
Pressure.
Yes, yeah. Unnecessary pressure. There's culture, there's tradition, and there are all these beliefs that people have, you know, ideologies, and
people don't even announce that they're pregnant anymore.
Exactly.
Oh yeah.
No, so they call it hashtag Team Hiding Belly on Instagram.
Oh, really?
Like, oh yeah, Team Hiding Belly, and I'm like, really? Who really? You know. But that's not to ignore the fact that there's lots of women that have this as an issue, and according to WHO, 98% of all married couples would at least, I think 97% will get pregnant after the first 1 year, and another 2% after 2 or 3 years. So just about 0.0. It's just a very little minute percentage. But for those people, for those couples, or for those families, they are going through really hard times. I mean, listening to your story, I can only imagine how hard it must have been, you know. So it's real. Infertility is real, and there are people dealing with it. But you shouldn't worry about it until a year of regular unprotected sexual intercourse.
And when one finds out that, oh, they are infertile, or they just found out, yes, what is the way out? Is that the end of the road for them?
It's not the end of the road. The next step is to seek help, see a medical doctor. Now, what we advise in the hospital or in the clinic is, come with your husband. You know, a lot of men, they're like, oh, yeah, the woman, go and see the doctor. But you would even be surprised that you may do a sperm count and find out that the man has, you know, probably a low sperm count, you know, or there are lots
and
of
and in
issues.
Nigerian movies, it's always the fault of a woman.
It's always
and I think they perpetrate this wrong stereotype.
Even in real life, it's the fault. I've had countless of patients that will come to clinic and their husbands do not understand why they should even come with them, you know, because it's really hard on the woman. Mm. It's really hard on the woman. Really hard on the woman. Losing a child, not being able to get pregnant is really hard on, because everyone looks at the couple and they just see
single
the woman.
Out,
oh,
yeah,
they single out the woman that, you know, it's the fault of the woman. There are many causes, actually. So seeing a doctor would help too. There are lots of tests that will be run. And that's why I told that couple that there are tests that I can, you know, advise you to do. But I don't think I would want to talk to. I told her, go and enjoy your marriage. You know, so, but once you see a doctor, the doctor will recommend all the tests that both the man and the woman can carry out and then proceed from there, the next step forward.
Mm. Okay, Tade.
Yes, Tade, apart from regular counseling, your foundation offers women that must have...
What we actually do, because I'm not even a counselor, what we do is we have hangouts once a month and it's divided into two. It's pair-led hangouts, which is more or less a support group, and there's information-based hangouts. So the information-based one is topic by topic. We take on different, like, for example, there could be one solely focusing on PCOS, and we'll get a doctor talking about the medical aspect, people that have gone through the journey and come out of it in relation to PCOS and discuss it and get everybody else to ask questions.
It's a very sensitive and taboo topic in a sense of it. So how's the reception been, especially knowing that we're in Africa, Nigeria, to be
what I realized is a lot of Nigerians are not as secretive as we might think. They just don't have an outlet that they could trust. And that's what we're trying to do. Obviously, there are a lot of people that are like, no, I'm not. But now we're more proactive, you know, in terms of seeking help, in terms of seeking support, understanding your body. People are not waiting for 10 years before they go to seek help. Now it's 1 year, 2 years, you know, which really we advise 1 year to just go and make sure everything is okay and stuff. So, yeah, a lot of people have really been, you know, receptive.
Okay, so we're about to wrap up this conversation, but we're giving you the opportunity to be a part of this conversation. The phone lines are open. The numbers to call are on your screen. If you have a question, a comment or a contribution, now will be the time to make them. So, Tade, let's quickly ask you. A lot of people have this speculation now, this mindset of, oh, for you to have suffered from infertility, you must have led a certain kind of lifestyle. Mm-hmm. Did you ever experience that sort of, did you feel that way?
Funny enough, I was a virgin when I met my husband. So when I realized I was dealing with infertility, I was so pissed off because I'm like, everybody's going to think I'm so loose. Everybody's going to think, oh gosh, Tade must have done this. She must have offended someone. And that wasn't even the case. So, you know, in terms of the stereotype and stuff, I really feel so bad for people that have to deal with, you know, all of that, because you could be as amazing, you could be as honest, as caring, as anything as possible, but you could still deal with this issue. So it's not about you, it's just about what you've gone through. And I always tell people that it's so somebody else can, you can support somebody else, because if you don't go through it, someone else going through it, you wouldn't know what to say, you wouldn't be able to relate to them. So it's not necessarily you being punished for something, it's just the fact that somebody else is struggling and you need to understand it, go through it to be able to support that person.
Okay. And
very well. Dr. Ezenwanne, my question for you is this. How can you prevent a miscarriage? Is it prevent? Of course, it's preventable. Yeah, but what are the things to avoid? Is it when you're pregnant?
Okay, so miscarriage or abortion. You know, we call it abortion in the hospital, but in this part of the world, people don't want to say, no, not an abortion. They think, you know, you did it on purpose. But for people that have miscarriages, spontaneous miscarriages, it's important that for those, because they're high.
Because I've seen people gymming in the whip. Pregnancy, I don't know if that is dangerous.
No, pregnancy is actually a physiological condition. We always tell people that it's not pathological. The person is not sick. The person can actually still carry on life as usual. Yeah. But the thing is, there are some pregnancies that we call precious pregnancies. You know, and on the file of the woman, we'll even write precious baby, you know, something to indicate the fact that this is
fragile.
A high risk. Yes, there are high risk pregnancies and there are low risk pregnancies. So for a woman that has probably dealt with infertility and she's now, you know, coming to the hospital and, you know, she's pregnant, for instance, it's important that you encourage her to take adequate rest, you know, ensure that all the necessary tests are done, you know, and then basically a lot of rest. It's not, there's nothing, you know, there's nothing. If a woman has had miscarriage for a long time, or maybe the first, second or third, or, you know, like I said, the pregnancy is deemed to be high risk.
Then speaking of risk, what are the risk factors for infertility? Very quickly, please.
The risk factors for infertility, like there could, for the male, because there is the male factor and there's female factor. So that's, we don't call it, okay, so there's male factors and there's female factors. Mm. For the male factors, it could be the sperm. What we usually do is just do a sperm analysis. But for the female factors, it could be PCOS, that's polycystic ovarian syndrome. There could be a blocked fallopian tube, either one or two of the tubes have been blocked. And that could, and that's why you asked that question, that for some people that maybe have been promiscuous, that could probably have been from a sexually transmitted disease. For example, when PID is not treated, a patient has PID and is not adequately treated, it could lead to a blocked.
What's,
you
know, PID?
PID is pelvic inflammatory disease. So if that's not treated, so if that's not treated properly, that could also lead to complications. Now, for some people that have had abortions on purpose, then they could have adhesions in their uterus, as their womb could form adhesions and then prevent a pregnancy from being implanted in the uterus.
Okay.
So there are lots of factors actually that could cause.
And for those of you who want to find out what the other factors are, you can follow Dr. Kemi at the Dr. Kemi on all social media platforms. Tade, do you have a social media account?
Yes, yes, yes. BEIBEIHAVEN.
All right, BEIBEIHAVEN, baby heaven. If you want to be a part of our event that is happening this Saturday at Echo Hotel, what time is your event?
It's from 9 a.m. in the morning to around 12.
All right.
And really want to focus on helping people, the general populace, understand the do's and don'ts, what to say, what not to say with someone that is struggling with this issue, because a lot of people have a misconception. They end up doing the wrong thing that will upset the person.
Very true.
And obviously there's a lot of support after the summit for people that are still struggling with this issue.
All right. Yeah. There's so much we need to talk about, but you can follow them on their social media platforms. Thank you for sharing your story, Tade.
Thank you.
And congratulations. You have a baby boy now. And yesterday was his second birthday.
Yes.
Wow. Happy birthday to your baby.
Happy birthday.
I hope this inspires hope in your heart. If you've been having challenges having a baby, you can have your story.
I mean, happy story.
Yes, very true. We'll go on a break. When we come back, we'll be wrapping up the show. Please stay with us.
To enjoy more of this our Ogonge videos when you just watch, press this button to subscribe on top of our YouTube page. You go love her.